He's not asking to be prayed for so that the battle stops. He's not asking to be prayed for so that he doesn't experience attacks. What he's asking to be prayed over him is that whatever his circumstance is, he continues to advance the gospel. That the battle line still continues to move forward so that he continues to see victory in the spiritual war. This is the last week of our Supernatural Realm series. We're talking about spiritual warfare. The first week, to get an understanding of what we've been doing, the first week we dealt with understanding the spiritual realm itself. There's not a lot of talk about that because, well, putting the pieces together throughout all of Scripture can be difficult. So we took a look at what the actual spiritual realm looks like, because how can you fight in the war if you don't even know what the battlefield looks like? Last week, we talked more about what sort of tactics and objectives the enemy has for you and how they fight you. Because just like in sports, you want to know what the tactics of the other team is or the other person is so that you know how to counter attack. So that's what we spent last week doing. This week, as we close it up, we're going to be talking about what resources you have available so that you can understand how to fight the spiritual war yourself. So we're going to be in Ephesians chapter 6, verses 10 through 20. That's the only place we're going to be hanging out tonight. So if you want to follow along, Ephesians 6, chapter 6, verses 10 through 20. Now, when you think about spiritual warfare, or if you've ever even heard a sermon series or someone dealing with spiritual warfare, this is typically the first place they go. We didn't start there because I don't think it's beneficial to know what weapons or defenses you have if you don't even know what the battlefield looks like. It doesn't matter if you have a shield and a sword if you don't even know where you're standing and you don't know what's around you. That's why we started where we started, dealing with the spiritual realm, and then understanding what the enemy has in terms of objectives, what's their goal, and what sort of tactics they use to achieve their goal, so that you can better understand how to fight the enemy. All right, so let's dig into it. Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God, that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this age, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in the heavenly places. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand. So Paul is pointing out in the book of Ephesians that this is your kit. This is your weapons kit. These are the tools you have at your disposal to fight the spiritual battle. He even points out that what we wage war against is not flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers of darkness and rulers of darkness in this world, in this age. And so that's what we're fighting. This is the toolkit you have at your disposal to fight this war. So let's look at it and find out what we can do. Verse 14, stand therefore, having girded your waist with truth, having put on the breastplate of righteousness. So right away, the first thing he says is that you have a belt of truth, girded your waist with truth. It's speaking of a belt. To give you a visual of this, how many of you have seen Star Wars? Okay, great. Everybody, that's not a shock. In Star Wars, you see the Jedi and the Sith wear these like long tunic robes, right? You know what I'm talking about? They all kind of have those long robes. But tied on the robes, they all have this belt that their lightsaber attaches to. That belt is exactly what would have happened in the biblical time when this was being written. People wore tunics. They wore long flowing clothes that just went over their whole body. And so when someone who was getting ready for a fight, that was the clothes they had available to them. So in order to get ready for the fight, they would put a belt around the tunic so that it lifted it the bottom up so that it wasn't in the way of your feet. You weren't going to trip over yourself when the waist was tied closed, and then the bottom of the hem of the garment was lifted up above your ankles so that you had room to run and maneuver so that you didn't trip over yourself. Because that's the last thing you want to do in a battle. And so what is Paul saying? You have the belt of truth. So truth is the thing that gives your feet room to run, to prevent you from tripping over yourself. Because if you trip over yourself in a battle and you fall on your face, you become completely vulnerable to the enemy's attack. So what is truth? Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. Jesus also pointed out in Luke 24 that the Old Testament, the scriptures themselves, were about him. And so Jesus is the truth, and the scriptures, which is all of the scriptures, speak about him. He is the truth. If you don't know the truth, or if the truth gets twisted, that's like your belt loop coming undone and making it easy for you to trip over the lies. And if you buy into a lie of what is really true about God's word, you can trip over yourself and make yourself vulnerable to the enemy's attack for him to take advantage of you and your faith because you don't have the truth to help you in battle, to give you room to run and maneuver. It's too easy to fall flat. And being on the ground is not the place you want to be. That's another Star Wars reference. Remember how Anakin lost in the third movie? Obi-Wan had the high ground. It is the truth. In battle, especially in ancient battle, when you're dealing with close-knit hand-to-hand combat, the high ground is helpful. You have better positioning. You have better view. Your arrows will fly farther and more accurately downhill than uphill. So you have the advantage if you have the high ground. That's how it works. So if you fall on the ground, your enemy has the advantage. So the truth gives you a place to maneuver and to run around. Now the breastplate of righteousness, here's the interesting thing. What does the breastplate cover? Your chest. It covers where your heart is. What it's saying is those who have taken what Jesus has said and lived by his words. Because what Jesus said was, those who love me will do what I command. They will follow my commands. If you live according to Christ's commands, if you live biblically, if you live righteously, it means that you are putting a shield, you are putting a defense mechanism over your heart. Those who don't live righteously expose their heart to the world to get destroyed. It's very similar to what we talked about at the overnight. If you allow the wrong influence to get too close to your heart, the wounds can go deeper. But if you live according to the word of God, if you live according to the way that Jesus taught, it actually shields your heart because you're living in a way that prevents hurt, that covers your heart. And your heart is living for the right thing. You're loving God first, not the world first. So the breastplate of righteousness protects your heart. The belt of truth is what Jesus said, or what is said about Jesus in Scripture. Scripture gives you the ability to maneuver in the spiritual war. Verse 15, having shod your feet with the preparation of the gospel of peace. I think this part of the spiritual armor might be talked about the least and should be talked about maybe the most. Now, if you've ever listened to someone talk about spiritual warfare, they often talk about the sword being the one true offensive weapon in the toolkit. That's not true. What shields your feet, having shod the footwear that you use, allows you to advance. That's the point. Your feet tell you which direction you're going. Are you standing still? Are you moving forward? Or are you moving backward? In a battle, if you're retreating, you're losing. If you're standing still, you're not winning. If you're advancing, you are winning. You are moving forward. And what Paul says is that what you do to advance, what you do to win, is to shod your feet with the gospel. The gospel is the thing that needs to advance. If the gospel is not advancing because of what you are doing, you are not winning the war. This also tells you what the war is actually about. And this might surprise you, but the spiritual attacks that you get have nothing to do with you personally. The enemy does not care about you. The enemy cares about hurting God and his mission. You just happen to be in the way, if you love him. And so if he can get you to stand still and stand your ground and make sure that you don't spread the gospel, then at least God's message isn't being spread. If he can get you to retreat, he's winning and he's beating you, really because his goal is to prevent God's mission. It's not about you. Interestingly, what God says is that he cares about you. His mission is your salvation. That is exactly what Jesus came to do. He came to suffer and die on the cross because he cares about you and your eternal life. God cares for you. The enemy cares about hurting God. He doesn't care about you at all. And whatever he can do to get you off of God's mission is him winning. And so your feet, are you advancing? And the only way to win the war is to advance the gospel. It's not about making sure that you pray more or read your Bible more or, right, going to church more, coming to youth group enough. Those things are good things, and they can prepare you to do spiritual war, but they are not spiritual warfare in itself. Spiritual warfare in itself is you advancing the gospel. So are you taking the things you learn and do? Are you taking your devotionals? Are you taking the time you go at church? Are you taking your worship and your prayer personally and doing something with it to advance the mission of the gospel? If you're not advancing, you're not winning. Because that is the gospel of peace. Shodding your feet with that, advancing in a war, means you're winning. Now, above all, verse 16, taking the shield of faith with which you will be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked one. Now, faith is the thing, your main protection. It's something you can maneuver to stop the arrows from coming at you. Now, interestingly, this is written at a time by Paul the Apostle, written at a time when the army that never lost a war, the Roman army, existed on the planet. Now, the Roman army, their tactic in fighting war was to march in legions, in groups, and they would march lockstep together, and everyone on the perimeter of the march held their shield out in front of them. Anyone inside of the perimeter held the shield up. So it blocked all arrows firing towards them because they basically made themselves like a turtle shell as they marched along, and it was impossible to engage them at a distance because they protected themselves. So they were always able to advance because you couldn't get them when they were far away because their shields were up. So you could only attack them hand-to-hand combat, which they won all the time. They overwhelmed people with numbers, and they had better training because they knew that that's what they were training for, while the rest of the world was using the best military advancement, archery, that they completely figured out a way to get around by putting up all of their shields. So a shield is a defense mechanism. Your faith is the defense mechanism. I think of David in the moment when he fought Goliath. David was not a trained soldier. He wasn't even in the army. In fact, David was just a shepherd who occasionally played a harp for the king when he walked onto the battlefield. When he walked onto the battlefield against Goliath, the trained army of Israel and the king that everybody looked to as the big baddie on the scene because he was head and shoulders taller than all the other Israelites stood as a coward in his tent. While the shepherd boy stepped onto the battlefield, and he stepped onto the battlefield not because he was bigger and stronger, but because he had faith in a God who was bigger than the enemy. And that faith led him to victory because he was protected by his faith. So faith is a protector. Verse 17, and take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. So the helmet of salvation, this is the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. That you've come to know intellectually and believed in your heart that Jesus Christ saved you, that he died on the cross, he is God made flesh, died on the cross and resurrected on the third day to pay the debt of your sin, and you've put your faith in him. That saving knowledge is the helmet of salvation. If you have salvation and you are sealed by the Holy Spirit, you are protected from attacks against the enemy, and you are protected against the most fatal shot, the headshot. And then you take the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God, which is Scripture, which speaks about Jesus. And this is the weapon that you both use to thrust and parry. Those are fencing terms. A thrust is an offensive move where you swing at the enemy, and a parry is a defensive move where you block the thrust of your enemy, the sword. Interestingly, this is exactly what Jesus did when he was tempted in the desert. When Jesus was tempted by Satan, he parried, he defended, and blocked the attacks of Satan, who even used Scripture against Jesus. And he blocked that attack by using Scripture correctly in context and swung that at Satan to defeat him and not be tempted by Satan. Jesus was not tempted by Satan because he correctly used the Word of God in context to answer all the attacks of the enemy. This also might give us some insight into how to speak against the enemy. Whatever we say, if we come in contact with a serious issue where we're really physically being attacked by the enemy, if we speak words that align with Scripture, we're more likely to create a successful thrust, a successful attack against the enemy. If we're just saying things out of emotion, we're not attacking correctly because we're not wielding the Word of God. The Word of God is the sword that you must thrust to win that battle. Verse 18, praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, being watchful to this end with all perseverance and supplication for all the saints. Verse 19, and for me, that utterance may be given to me, that I may open my mouth boldly to make known the mystery of the gospel, for which I am an ambassador in chains, that I may speak boldly as I ought to speak. Now, the last verse there in verse 20 tells us the interesting thing, that Paul is writing this letter from prison. He's someone who's in the midst of a spiritual battle, and he's in prison, he's in chains, but his letters advance the gospel. Even when the enemy has him tied up, he's still finding a way to win. And he's pointing out that it's not always going to be easy. The battle rages on, but push forward, like Paul, who's an ambassador of Christ. And what he says is to pray. Pray always with the prayer and supplication in the Spirit, being watchful to this end, with all perseverance and supplication for all the saints, and for me, that utterance may be given to me, that I may open my mouth boldly to make known the mystery of the gospel. So what is the thing he is praying for? He's not praying. He's not asking to be prayed for so that the battle stops. He's not asking to be prayed for so that he doesn't experience attacks. What he's asking to be prayed over him is that whatever his circumstance is, he continues to advance the gospel. That the battle line still continues to move forward so that he continues to see victory in the spiritual war. Because Paul understood the spiritual battle, what was really at stake. And it wasn't about whether or not Paul was suffering. It was about whether or not the gospel was advancing. Because that is the sign that you are winning. Instead of retreating when life got hard, or when he was imprisoned for his own beliefs, and for preaching the gospel of Christ, he got put in chains. Instead of being stopped, he asked for a way for the gospel to still advance, because Paul wanted to win the war, because he understood what the war was really about. You are in the war to either advance or retreat from the gospel. Those are your options to win or lose, because that's what spiritual war is really about. Jesus reclaiming the world as God's, the one true God. The world belongs to him, and the salvation of his people is him winning that war. And he already claimed victory on the cross, but you and I get to participate. And even though we may not be judged for our sin because we stand before God as saved because we received Christ's blood on the cross, we will stand before Jesus and get rewarded or not rewarded for how we served him in the war. I don't really want to stand before Jesus and have him look at me, and even though I'm saved, it's only me. I didn't really do anything. I didn't earn anything else. Because that was good enough for me. I just stood in neutral, or I retreated from the gospel. I didn't help him win the war. And that was my entire role in the first place. I want to stand before him and get a crown because he knows that I helped him advance. I fulfilled the mission because I listened to his words and obeyed him and put on the breastplate of righteousness and allowed the gospel to advance. That's the goal of spiritual war. Let's pray. Father God, thank you. Thank you for the words of Paul. And God, I pray that we've learned something throughout this series, that we've understand the spiritual realm and spiritual war better. And I pray, Lord God, that you give us the power in your spirit and the strength and knowledge of wisdom and truth to do what we need to do to advance the gospel, to help win the war, that you know, seeing the end from the beginning, you've already won. I pray that my part helps. In Jesus' name, amen.